Dear Vikram, Kailas, we appreciate and respect the sentiments you have expressed in your speech. And we pray to God that that great soil, Turkey, be given strength divinely so that it stands the test of time, as it is today also coming up. Whenever there is an issue, they come up and they stand with it. I believe that the people there will continue to have strong faith, and that old culture they will always keep in mind and show the path. But at the same time, they should come up the best in the values of equality, justice and fraternity. Now is the time to listen to one of the very good scholars. He is Professor Faizan Mustafa, Vice Chancellor, Namsar University, Law, Hyderabad, and he will deliver the valedictory address. As a colleague at Aligarh, I will tell him, Faizan.
Assalamu alaikum. Dignitaries on the dais, and my first warden in Aligarh, Janab Naseem Zaidi Sahab, my senior of Aligarh and colleague, Vice Chancellor of Central University in Kashmir, colleagues, my senior of VM Hall, Shakil Bhai, and some of my youngsters, my students. In last 20 days, three times I was not given the liberty of what I wanted to do. And I will come to this thing in a minute, because I feel that the missing word in the topic is liberty. So there was a seminar, bicentenary celebrations of Sir Syed Ahmad Khan in Aligarh, in the Department of History. And I was tied up with something else, and therefore I didn't want to go and give the inaugural address. But I was forced, because ultimately my teacher, Professor Irfan Habib's will had to prevail. Then on 4th, there was an international conference on South Asian Consortium of Religion and Law, where in the original meeting it was not decided that I will give the valedictory address, but then Professor Tahir Mahmood phoned me and said, we have unanimously decided and you don't have a choice. So I was not given a liberty, I had to give another valedictory within 5 days. And this time also, believe me, I tried my best to somewhat escape from this prestigious seminar, but then the will of Honorable Chairperson Munzur Alam Sahab, who has been a mentor for 3 decades, prevailed, and his connection with his God also worked, because I was thinking that we will have today our court meeting, which is called General Council at Nalsar, to pass the budget. And he said, no, 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 the Chief Justice will not give you 18 as a date. So it did not happen, and I am here. My association with IOS started sometime in 93-94, but I distinctly remember that when we had the first decade celebrations in 1996, then my second book was released. I have not been writing that well, because administration is having a very heavy toll, and I don't consider op-eds in newspapers as academic contribution. These are just, you can't do much. You don't do real research, so you write off in an hour or two, something. So that's not an academic contribution. So my best wishes are with the Institute, and the Institute has made a great contribution. I missed the deliberations of the first 2 days, but I feel that the seminar program was overloaded. We had too many sessions, parallel sessions. Very eminent people spoke, and on topics of very high contemporary relevance. So as I said that the kind of training which I received at Aligarh, and law being nothing but a game of words, I feel that fraternity and equality and justice cannot be talked about without liberty. And therefore, for a minute or two, let me talk of the missing word. Ambedkar, who was the chairman of the drafting committee, and as you know, the constitution was, the drafting was completed on 26th of November 1949, and this was his last speech on the 25th of November 1949. Next day everybody will say that we adopt the constitution. So I am on the last speech of Ambedkar, and this is what he said. We must not be content with mere political democracy. Political democracy cannot last unless there lies at the base of it social democracy. What does social democracy mean? It means a way of life which recognizes liberty, equality and fraternity as principles of life. I have this problem with we say we are the largest democracy in the world. Yes, every 5 years we do have elections. Governments come and go. But democracy has not been imbibed by us in our personal life. We are not democratic. We don't want to listen dissent. We don't want to give choice to even our family members. I recall a survey done many years ago about the choices as to breakfast, what will be served in breakfast, who decides? Whether the lady of the house decides, or the mister decides, or sons decide. And overwhelmingly the respondents who were IAS officers, who were professors, engineers and doctors, they said it's the man who decides. So if she does not have even the freedom to decide what will be served in breakfast and we decide whether it will be aloo ka paratha or poha or chole bhature or nahari, then probably we are not near imbibing and inculcating principles of liberty, equality and fraternity as principles of life. They are there in the constitution, but not as principles of our life. Ambedkar goes on, this was my commentary on his first sentence, but let me complete the quote. These principles of liberty, equality and fraternity are not to be treated as separate in terms in a as separate items in a trinity, and that's why I say it is missing, it should be there. They form a union of trinity in the sense that to divorce one from the other is to defeat the very purpose of democracy. So you have to have all three of them, and if you have all three of them, you will get justice. Liberty, Ambedkar continued, cannot be divorced from equality, and that's why I'm bringing in liberty to talk on equality. Liberty cannot be divorced from equality. Equality cannot be divorced from liberty. Nor can liberty and equality be divorced of fraternity. Without equality, mind these words, this is the architect of Indian constitution. Without equality, liberty would produce supremacy of few over many. Yeh hai na hamari Darwinian theory, survival of the fittest. So if you don't have equality and you have just liberty, the best will excel. But marginalized, haves not, disabled, not very talented, they will not excel. Therefore, few will become rich, as I am going to tell you in a minute. What kind of equality we have, 1% people having 73% of the national wealth. So without equality, liberty, and that is the whole criticism of J.S. Mill. Without equality, liberty will produce supremacy of few over the many. Equality without liberty would kill individual initiative. That is what happened in the Soviet Union and other socialist countries. Equality you have and you don't have liberty, enterprise will not happen. Business will not grow. Economy will not grow. It will stagnate. Because there is no initiative. You have such an eminent economist sitting in front of me, Nasim Zari sir. Individual initiative will not grow if you have equality and you don't have liberty. Then he goes on and says, without fraternity, both liberty and equality could not become a natural course of things. It would require a constable to enforce them. Therefore, you need liberty, you need equality, and you need fraternity, and then you get justice. This is my central argument. Therefore, coming to liberty, now you know the importance of liberty. Why it has been left out. I was here for about an hour and a half. There was an overloaded discourse on theology, with so much of verses from Quran being quoted and cited. And that is a problem of many of our seminars, that we convert them into jalsas. Seminar is to be different from a religious discourse. A seminar is an intellectual discourse talking about worldly things. I don't think in this topic there is anything to do with religion. But if you look at Muslim countries' example, and I say it with highest amount of respect to my guest from Turkey, where is liberty in Muslim countries? They are not great votaries of liberty. And why they are not great votaries of liberty? When we are talking of Lahaf-ud-Din here, and we are not permitting non-Muslims to construct temples. What Modi ji did was an aberration. In any case, UAE is liberal amongst them. And I don't want to go to the politics. Liberty is important because it means choice. Liberty is important because it means freedom. Liberty is important because it means absence of restraints and controls. It is important because it gives individual autonomy. I have to be the master of myself. It's a shame that we are anti-choice. That's why Christians, Jews, Muslims, if it is a campaign, anti-abortion campaign, all of them join together in the United States. Because they don't want to give choice to the mother to abort the fetus. Individual freedom is denied in many Muslim countries. And when you deny individual freedom, what really happens? The state imposes its will. The state decides for you, what will you eat? As is happening in even some of the constitutional democracies, unfortunately. So whether you will eat beef or you will not eat beef, state will decide. That's why it will come up with beef statutes. Women are not allowed to drive. Some happy changes, small changes happening in Saudi Arabia under US pressure. But this is not what our theology is. I'm not going to quote Quran. But in terms of choice, in the state which Prophet, peace be upon him, created, even holidays choice was given. So if you are a Christian, you will have Sunday as a holiday. If you are a Jew, you will have Saturday as your Sabbath. And of course, Muslims will have it on Friday. Even sale of pork was permitted. Even trade of liquor was permitted in the holy city of Medina because of choice, if it is your choice. So much so that the charter of Medina, the treaty of Medina, was not between Muslims and non-Muslims because specific names of the tribes are mentioned. So you retain your choice of being identified to the group to which you really belong. Liberty, in my opinion, is therefore necessary for any constitutional democracy. Liberty, in my opinion, is the condition precedent for democratic justice and for what I call spiritual democracy. If you want to allow me freedom of religion, this is also democracy. If I want to exercise my freedom of religion, that means there are areas which I don't want to be governed by the state. It is my choice that in these matters I don't submit myself to the state. And therefore my law will come from some other source, not the state. Right is government's word over our anti-liberty. I just gave you the example of anti-abortion campaigns, anti-sexual minorities, anti-religious minorities, anti-linguistic minorities. Maharashtra is only for Maratha Manus, not for others. Right is Shiv Sena. Anti-freedom of Dalits. Anti-immigrants. Look what Trump is doing. America is only for Americans and preferably for white Americans. Anti-women. Anti-blacks. Pro-death penalty. Pro-religion of the majority. If it is a monarchy and you don't have liberty, the religion of the king will be imposed on you. If it is a democracy, you will have majoritarianism. This is no liberty. And therefore, the current status of liberty is problematic. If I don't have the liberty to eat what I want, now the Supreme Court has said, 9-judge bench, it's a violation of my privacy. What I eat is my private business. If I don't have the liberty to marry whom I want to marry, and you want to impose your will, look at the whole debate on Hadia, then you are denying me liberty, and this is no justice. If I want to convert to any religion, it is my choice, because religion is not a public thing. It is a private thing. Whether I change it or I don't change it, it is none of the business. But how many of us are going to say, in a modern constitutional democracy, death penalty for blasphemy is not right? We don't have that guts and courage to say so. And I am not going into the religious argument, because even religious argument is controversial. For a death penalty for blasphemy, somebody who is not a Muslim. But what is the business of the state to tell me whom I marry, when at the same time the state says living is permitted? The two don't go together. Whether I marry or I don't marry, it is none of the business of the state, because I have a choice, I have a liberty. Right is government or anti-liberty, as I said. Therefore, in the NEET examination, we did not permit even a nun in a scarf to appear in the exam. It's her choice if she wants to be in hijab. No more hijab is imposed on women against their will. Probably it happened in 17th, 18th, 15th century, no more. The educated Muslim women of US or Europe put on hijab as a matter of choice. Therefore, it is their choice. We need to respect that choice. To say that I don't have a freedom to oppose a decision, and for everything I must just say yes, yes, like a buck, this is anti-liberty and stand. And if there is liberty, then I must have a liberty to follow whatever I feel like. It is a denial of liberty if a child is killed who has just made some shopping, traveling in a train near E, because he has put on a cap. Just like her choice of hijab, putting of a cap is also the choice. And we kill it, and others keep quiet. if our high courts even go to such an extent that we say that the accused killed the victim because of the religion of the victim. Day before now, the Supreme Court has said that this is absurd observation which the Bombay High Court should not have made while granting bail in the case of Mohsin. Liberty means you will not kill me if allegedly in my refrigerator there is beef. This is what happened with Aula. Liberty would mean that you will not kill Pehlu Khan just because he is into a dairy business. And therefore more freedom in a liberalized economy, if I can construct my argument in an economic terms in reverence to my warden, more freedom in liberalized economy should be accompanied by greater liberty, particularly religious liberty. If people want to follow a particular religion, they are to be free to follow that religion. That brings me to the question of equality. While in your sessions, special business sessions, ideally one should speak only on one topic: liberty, equality, fraternity, or a part of equality, part of a liberty. But in an inaugural and valedictory, you have to sum up the entire thing. That's why I'm going to speak on rest of the two or three, justice, fraternity as well, and equality. So as to equality, should we have only some formal sense of equality? Of course, the constitution in the preamble will talk of equality of status and of opportunity. Then you have Article 14 talking of equality. Then you have other articles in the constitution talking of reducing income inequalities. Then you have articles saying there are prohibited grounds on which the state will not discriminate. So you will not deny me equality in the name of religion, in the name of sex, in the name of my birthplace. These are prohibited grounds. But in the United States, the whole right to equality has been hijacked by the corporates. And in India, right to equality is being used to deny me equality. That is the tragedy of our times. I am uneducated, underrepresented. My educational and social status is less than SCs and STs. Number of articles were written by sir on this. But if I want affirmative action, I am told, no, there cannot be a reservation for Muslims because of equality. We have given a new discourse to equality to say that the haves not will not get it because equality. As many as three judgments from Andhra Pradesh High Court is striking down Muslim reservation. Even though the constitution said that there shall not be, state shall not discriminate only on the ground of religion, race, caste, sex, place of birth, we have conveniently forgotten only. When I am given reservation, it is not because I am a Muslim. It is given because I am socially and economically and educationally backward. Equality, you will not have your right to follow personal law because others have reformed their personal law. So if we got Hindu court, then you should also got uniforms. This is no equality. You have turned the discourse on equality. Why? Because we are only into formal equality. Are even formal equality says lives are to be treated alike. So if I am like you, then I will be given the same treatment which you get. Even Article 14 permits classification, reasonable classification. Unlikes can't be treated alike. In liberty, we talked of the best. Ambedkar saying, if you have liberty, it will lead to supremacy of few if you don't have equality. How will I compete with highly educated Brahmin when, in terms of my education, when in terms of my economic status, social status, two of us are not the same? Therefore, formal equality is not enough. We need substantive equality. And substantive equality will demand classifications, differentiations, acknowledgement of my weakness. I am disabled. I am not equal. You have to make a special dispensation for me. You have to make a special provision for me. In a fair race, I can never win. But we have turned this debate into equality in denying poor, in denying downtrodden their legitimate expectation of state walking an extra mile. State doing a whole handing is equality. In the name of equality, you have left me high and dry. You have abandoned me because others don't need handholding. Since others did not get handholding, you will not get handholding. This is no equality. The whole problem with the Mandal Commission is this, as approved by the Supreme Court in Indira Swamy, that the 11 yardsticks set by Mandal Commission to determine the backwardness status are outdated. And you have put an impossible condition that I will be recognized as a backward only when the gap between me and the general candidate is of 25 percentage points. So whether water is available within 2 kilometers, this is a requirement, a determinant, a yardstick to determine backwardness. Now state is providing, in last 70 years, has provided drinking water, piped water. Whether I have a kacha house, pakka house, whether I have a rate of literacy, class 10, these parameters have become dated. And that's why I was in agreement with Mohan Bhagwat ji that we need to review reservation. And we must review reservation because Mandal Commission is coming in way of affirmative actions grant to number of groups which richly deserve it. Denial of knowledge. Is violation of equality. It was the duty of the state to provide me education. And the constitution clearly said, no TV channel anchor is reading the constitution, that state in giving aid cannot discriminate against a minority institution. What was your duty to provide me education? You are not providing. I invest my resources. In terms of money, in terms of infrastructure, in terms of time. And I am willing to educate 50% of non-minorities also. Yet you say, oh, in a secular democracy, how can an aided institution can be a minority institution with reservation? Thank God, Some sense has now prevailed, but I have been writing for 25 years or so. Minority doesn't mean only Christians and Muslims. So now a BJP member has gone to the Supreme Court saying Hindus should also be given a minority. He said in 7 states and union territories we should be given a minority status, including Kashmir. I had to write, why 7? You are already a minority in all the states. Because the constitution is talking of linguistic minority and religious minority. So in some states like Nagaland, you are a religious minority. Like Kashmir, you are a religious minority. But in other states, if I am a Brahmin of Tamil Nadu and I come to Delhi or Lucknow, I will be a minority under Indian constitution. I can set up a Tamil medium school in Lucknow, which will be a minority school. But if you deny minorities the right to set up their institutions, that means you want your hegemony to continue on knowledge. Did you not do it for centuries when you said Shudras will not be able to touch Vedas? You deny knowledge to us. I am told repeatedly, things have improved. Now why bother about inequality? Ab to untouchability bhi khatam ho gayi Mustafa sahab. Aap kis duniya mein rehte hain? You are so overcritical. Read the book called Ruler Untouchability in India. In more than 100 villages even today, a Dalit bridegroom cannot ride on a horse. उसकी बारात नहीं आ सकती घोड़े पे. Professor Sukhdev Thorat and Paul Attenwell of City University of New York did a remarkable study. In October 2005, for 66 continuous weeks, 66 hafte tak ye research chalti rahi. What was the research? The research was that they will look at the advertisements in newspapers, in the private sector, forget about the government, where you have some reservations, even though if you look at numbers, we are not able to fill all the seats which are reserved for SCs, STs and OBCs. Even at the current point of time, if you look at the number of secretaries, you will hardly find maybe one. So for 66 weeks, they will look at an advertisement for a job, and with set of resumes which are similar except in names, make identical applications. No mention of caste or religion, but it will be easily identifiable by name whether you are a Muslim or whether you are a Dalit or you are a higher caste. After 66 weeks, 4,808 applications were sent for 548 job advertisements. In the research, the parameter whether you have equality, you don't have equality, they said whether you get the call letter, selection ki baat nahi ho rahi. Mere liye to you heard, a year and a half ago, when a Muslim applied, a private company within minutes responding, we don't recruit Muslims. But look at the hard research. A call for interview, a call for interview was considered a success. And what are the findings? With Dalit name, the chances are 0.6%. With a Muslim name, 0.33%. compared to equally qualified high caste applicants. If I am not in interview, how can I be selected? And this is the status of our equality. If you look at National Labor Sample Survey, the gap of salary between a higher caste and lower caste is to the tune of 15%. Therefore, the constitutional ideal of equal wages for equal work are more illusionary than real. There is no diversity at workplaces. And the recent figures in terms of wealth, in 1 year, last year 1% richest had 58% of the wealth. In 1 year, this number has gone to 73%. Therefore, wealth of the elite in India increased by 20.9 lakh crore. And this is almost the size of national budget. 20.9 lakh crore. Whose wealth has increased? If I am a daily wager in the garment industry, whatever is my wage and what is the wage of an executive in that corporate, it will take me 941 years to reach that level. Almost 1,000 years I reached that level. In the entire history of billionaires, last year was unique. Every 2 days, one billionaire was created. Therefore, 1% people have seen 73% rise, and 67 crore Indians have experienced only 1% rise in their income. This is the status of our equality. Majority of 167 million Dalits work as landless or near landless labor in agricultural production. And yesterday's UN report, the difference between the life expectancy of a Dalit woman and a higher caste women is 14.5 years. Our Dalit women are dying at the age of 39. We should be ashamed of it. And therefore, I believe if at all there has to be a tax incentive, we must give tax incentives only to the corporates who do better on the diversity index. That brings me to the question of fraternity. I have been saying it for some time now. We have been talking of secularism too much. We have not talked enough of the other crucial word in the preamble of Indian Constitution, which is fraternity, which was inserted at the insistence of Ambedkar. What is fraternity? Bandhut, bhaichara, biradari, equality and mutual respect for each other. Fraternity is to be the goal of the society. And fraternity comes after justice, liberty, and equality. Fraternity is the fraternity can be achieved if we assure the dignity of the individual. Ambedkar says fraternity means a sense of common brotherhood of all Indians. If Indians are seen as being one people, it is the principle which gives unity and solidarity to social life. But it is a difficult thing to achieve. UDHR, Universal Declaration of Human Rights, Article 1 itself says, all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. They are endowed with reason and conscience and should act towards one another in the spirit of quote unquote brotherhood, which is fraternity. If you don't have fraternity and you talk of one nation, one law, one religion, one language, one tax, then it is antithetical to the idea of fraternity. Look at the very first word of the Constitution. It says, we the people. People are not one. People are different. And therefore their distinctive identities merge and make we the people. I will not be happy if my identity is melted in the melting pot, American melting pot as it is called. I would rather prefer as a salad bowl where my distinctive identity is acknowledged and recognized. Cultural policing is a fundamental attack on fraternity, under which you want to produce a monolithic, self-enclosed community with no form of interaction. Fraternity is all over in the Constitution. If you guarantee me freedom of religion, I will be a happy person. If you guarantee me equality, I will not be jealous of your wealth. And therefore, Indian Constitution attaches a very high importance to fraternity. Of course, as you know, that though the slogan was liberty, equality and fraternity in the French Revolution, when Robespierre proposed on 5th December 1790 that this liberty, equality and fraternity be written on uniform and flags of French people, it was rejected. And the slogan was finally adopted as late as 1848. Even revolutions produce dictators. The child of French Revolution was Napoleon Bonaparte, the dictator par excellence. And a dictator will not be interested in liberty, equality. Will be more interested on curbs, on controls, on restrictions. Therefore, Indira Gandhi brought in fundamental duties. And Napoleon brought in liberty, public order. This was the slogan. I believe if we want solidarity, if we want real unity within diversity, then we have to acknowledge that we need to accommodate people's preferences, their religious preferences, their cultural preferences, their linguistic preferences. So much so that the Indian Constitution makes a bold statement saying any section of Indian citizens having a distinct language, script or culture of its own shall have the right to conserve the same. And this is an absolute right, no restriction. Therefore, my script is also to be preserved. You can't be changing the script of my language. The Constitution gave that right. It's a shame